From Washington, D.C., this is Middle East Focus.
Welcome to Middle East Focus. I'm Alistair Taylor, MEI's editorial director. And today we're going to be talking about the challenges facing the U.S. military across the Middle East, from COVID-19 and ISIS to the turbulent situation in Iraq and Afghanistan. To help us make sense of what's going on and where things might be headed, we're joined today by a great guest, General Joseph Votel. General Votel retired as a four-star general in the United States Army after a nearly 40-year career, during which he held a variety of commands in positions of leadership, including most recently as commander of U.S. Central Command. He's a distinguished senior fellow on national security at MEI and the president and CEO of the nonprofit Business Executives for National Security. General Votel, welcome to the program, and thank you for joining us today.
Alistair, it's great to be with you. Thanks very much for inviting me.
I'd like to start with the issue that's been dominating the headlines and indeed our lives for the past month now, and that's COVID-19. How is it affecting the U.S. military, and what does it mean for our posture in the Middle East?
Well, this is certainly a serious challenge for us, and I think right now, in terms of how it's impacting the force, is that we've got to focus on protection of the forces, and we got to also focus in at the same time and maintain our readiness, and that is a very delicate balance that has to be addressed. I am certain, and as many of our listeners have probably seen in the media, there are reports where it is having some impact on some of the institutional aspects of the armed forces, basic military training and other things like that. So there are going to definitely be impacts. As far as the Middle East goes and COVID and how it may be impacting our posture there, I think what COVID has the opportunity and the potential to do is to add to the underlying tensions of the region. You know, there are a number of ongoing operations here, whether it's in Afghanistan or in Iraq and Syria, and so it could have some particular impact on that. It certainly will have an impact on the environment. It could lead to more refugees. It could impact our ability to respond to situations as we kind of deal with this. So I think there's a lot of unknowns in this right now, but it certainly is having an impact. And at this point, I think our focus needs to be on protecting the force.
Just digging down into that a little bit deeper, as a former commander, how do you strike that right balance between protecting the American strategic interests, especially in a vital region like the Middle East, and protecting the health and well-being of service members?
Well, I don't necessarily view this as a binary decision. You can do one or the other. To me, this is about maintaining a healthy force. And only by making sure that we prioritize that and make sure that we keep the force healthy can we actually continue to protect and preserve our interests. And so to me, it's pretty clear. There certainly is a balance to some extent, but the priority has to be to make sure that our forces are safe and remain healthy and capable of doing their missions, and that will give us the best way to protect our interests. Really important in this is leadership, and it's important to get decision making at the lowest levels. Local commanders that have a very good understanding of the situation are in the best position to make decisions about what their forces do and don't do. Commanders and leadership at higher level have to provide a supportive environment around that, make sure they've got all the right tools and other equipment and materials and other things they need to do their mission in this particular environment. But it really is critical that we lean on our leadership here, and we use good feedback loops that go up and down the chain of command to make sure we understand what's happening and we've got alignment and awareness and understanding of how we're approaching this situation. I think it's also important that we look to our partners. This is a time. Times of crisis like this are also times of that call on opportunities to share burdens, and then we have to look at how we use everybody working together to collectively protect our interests. And I'm not just talking about our partner military forces. I'm talking about other partners within the interagency that are forward deployed with us as well, and making sure that we are leveraging that and we're sharing the burden for what has to be done to protect our interests. The good thing about the Department of Defense and, you know, the service, of course, that I came from, the Army, is that we are a learning organization, and we have great young people and great leadership, and I am very confident that people are working through this right now, trying to identify ways that we can balance protecting our interests and also protecting the force. As the president of Business Executives for National Security, I would also encourage our government partners and military partners to be looking at what business is doing. There's a lot of good examples out there right now of whether it is multi-shift or split shift or other techniques that are being applied in business around the world that is allowing them to continue to pursue their business objectives, but at the same time, also protecting their workforce. So I think there's a lot of things that can be done to balance this. A lot of it is about leadership, and a lot of it is about making sure that we get decision-making at the right level.
While coronavirus may be dominating the news, it's far from the only issue affecting the Middle East. And I'd like to touch on a couple of other key areas as well, starting with Syria and the recent spike in ISIS activity. We've seen a number of high-profile attacks in central Syria over the past few weeks. How concerned are you at this point about a potential ISIS resurgence?
Well, I think we always have to be concerned about ISIS resurging here. As we've talked about in a number of different forums, and as we've come to understand over the lengthy history that we've had with ISIS, is this is a different organization. It's different than Al-Qaeda. It's different than other organizations that we have confronted in terms of its approach and its zealousness with which they pursue their objectives. So I think we have to be very, very concerned. I think in many cases we may not know exactly what's happening. So you look to an area like Idlib, for example, where we don't have a strong presence. It's very difficult for us to understand what happens, but there certainly is great number of Islamist groups and other Al-Qaeda and ISIS affiliated groups up there that are thriving in the chaos of that particular area. I've seen some reporting that indicates in the southern part of Syria that ISIS is actually taking advantage of some of the tensions and chaos down there to begin to recruit and do some other things. So I think we have to be very, very concerned about this particular organization.
What impact is the pandemic likely to have on the counter-ISIS effort?
Well, I think, first and foremost, I think as everyone would understand it, it has the potential to divert attention. Necessarily so, we have got to address this and we've got to be serious about this. As I made the point to a few moments earlier, that we have to protect the force in order to protect our interests. And so, we've got to prioritize that, and diverting attention to address that could impact the overall mission. I think the other aspect here is that COVID has the opportunity to add to instability in the area and contribute to the underlying tensions that we've talked about here. And all of this is fuel for terrorist organizations, certainly including ISIS, that look to take advantage of these periods and times of chaos and crisis to move forward, to pursue their own objectives, and otherwise so their kind of ideology much, much broader than they already have. So I think we have to be very, very concerned about how we handle this particular period.
Turning to Iraq, there have been a number of rocket attacks on military bases housing U.S. and allied troops in recent months. At this point, how serious of a threat do the Iranian proxies in Iraq pose?
Well, I think they do pose a serious threat, and principally because they're unpredictable and they're unregulated. I think the challenge with these groups right now is we are unsure of the control mechanism over them. In the past, the Iranian leader Qasem Soleimani seemed to be able to control them and provide instructions to them and moderate their activities to some extent. As you will recall, during the campaign against ISIS, we had to operate in the same environment with many of these groups, and there was a common sense that that there was a control mechanism on these groups not to come after U.S. or coalition partners while we were pursuing ISIS and pursuing the campaign plan. And that actually persisted for some time after the camp, at least the campaign against the physical caliphate was completed. But, you know, now in the wake of Qasem Soleimani's killing, I think it's less clear who is orchestrating the control over these organizations. And we may be seeing these organizations trying to establish a level of independence from Iran or from others here and act on their own beliefs and interests locally here. So I think this is particularly a concern here. I also think it is highlighting the inability or at best the extreme difficulty that the government of Iraq has in controlling these militia groups. There is a popular mobilization force law that's been on the books for several years now. It's not been implemented fully or certainly not fully enough to orchestrate control over these groups. It is important that the government of Iraq exercise its level of control and bring all of these forces, popular mobilization forces, Ministry of Defense, Ministry of Interior, the counterterrorism forces, all under the legitimate control of the government. This is a very, very important thing to do. And until that is done, we are going to continue to deal with this this situation with these rogue militia groups, and in this case, these Shia groups.
Since the killing of General Qasem Soleimani at the beginning of the year, the future of the U.S. troop presence in Iraq has been in question. How important is Iraq for the U.S. military, and how do you see that situation evolving moving forward?
Well, from my viewpoint, I think Iraq is very, very important. It sits at the nexus of the region. It's geostrategically important where it sits. It is a bridge between the Arab world, the Persian world, and the Levant. It's resource rich. It has an educated population, so it's just an important location to be. A good relationship with the government of Iraq, with the forces, the armed forces of Iraq, I think really promotes U.S. influence in the region. It safeguards our interests and it acts as a hedge against malign actors, to include Iran and other powers, regional or otherwise, who may want to exert their influence in that area. It is important long term that we try to find a balance here. I recall from my time as the CENTCOM commander, my visits with Prime Minister Abadi, who I saw almost on a regular basis. He used to always talk about this and remind me that they are very proud of their relationship with the Americans and the American forces, in particular in this campaign, but that they live in a difficult neighborhood. They are neighbors with Iran, so there has to be that has to be taken into consideration. So there does need to be a balance here, and I think for the United States, I do assess that our best recent relationship with Iraq was during the campaign against ISIS, when we were viewed as a behind the scenes reliable partner that was really focused on the common interest that we really shared. And that's what we need to move back towards as quickly and as effectively as we can. Iraq is important to us, I think, and is important to our interests in the Middle East long term.
Moving on to Afghanistan, you were a strong voice in support of a U.S. Taliban deal that would lead to intra-Afghan negotiations and a shift in the conflict to the political realm. How do you assess the current situation, and have things played out as you hoped?
Well, I think the situation is as expected. It's complex and it's Afghan hard, and it's going to be that way the whole time through this. And I don't think I had any delusions, or anybody else did, that just because we had some type of agreement with the Taliban that this was a done deal. And I think we're seeing just how complex and hard this is going to be, and it's going to continue to be that way. I certainly had hoped, I think, that the political leadership on both sides, on the government of Afghanistan side and certainly on the Taliban side, would see the need for compromise for the sake of the Afghan people. I think there's very few alternatives at this point. Progress, even slow, steady progress, is progress nonetheless. And I noted today in some of my morning reading here that there's been another agreement for, you know, exchange of a small number of prisoners back and forth. This doesn't rise to the level that we had hoped to be at, but it's another important step, and it's an incremental step. And so I think what we have to do is we will have to be patient, we have to be persistent, we have to continue to support both of these parties coming together and working through the issues, even if that takes a long period of time. This is what the hard work of diplomacy is really about. And this is what the sacrifice that our military forces, both from the United States and the coalition, have really fought for, to give this opportunity to get to a political discussion, recognizing that it's going to be a very difficult and complex discussion that's going to take a lot of time to complete.
Coronavirus, as it does everywhere, seemingly at the moment, has an impact here as well. I'm just curious as to how it's affecting the U.S. troop withdrawal from Afghanistan.
I don't know that it necessarily is. In each of these situations across the region, I'm sure there are some factors that have to be considered that are peculiar to that particular situation. But I think many of the same things we've talked about here are the same as that. I mean, we want to protect forces. We want to make sure that we aren't bringing forces back that might be asymptomatic and come back in the United States and then spread. So, you know, I think the normal precautions that are probably being put in place with the Department of Defense are probably what's taking place here right now. I don't know that this will necessarily slow down or accelerate or anything with the withdrawal of our forces from Afghanistan. Our planning is more mature and sophisticated than that. But certainly this is another factor that has to be worked into all of it.
We've already touched on the counter-ISIS effort, Iraq and Afghanistan, but COVID-19 is likely to have wide-ranging and unpredictable impacts on countries and conflicts across the Middle East. Taking a kind of macro view and looking at the region as a whole, what concerns you the most? Are there any areas that stick out that you're particularly worried about?
Well, I think the one thing that does really concern me is that this virus, COVID-19 virus, has the potential to create a spiraling effect on the already deep, long present underlying tensions of the region, whether that is poverty, whether it's employment, whether it's disenfranchisement, whether it's refugees and internally displaced people, or terrorism, or, you know, corrupt governance. These things are present across the region, not everywhere, but they're present across the region, and there are deep underlying tensions that are always present. And when you introduce another factor into this, particularly a factor like COVID-19 that is that requires careful attention to address and to roll back, that requires involved governments, that spreads fear and gets after people's confidence. This really has the opportunity, I think, to really have an impact on some of these deep underlying issues. And so this is, I think, the thing that concerns me the most about this virus in the Middle East.
We're running short on time, but as things play out in the weeks and months ahead, what will you be paying particularly close attention to?
I think it's always important to pay attention to the choices that leaders are making and the decisions that they are taking in these situations. And so we should be focused very, very carefully on how leadership in the Middle East is addressing this particular threat and how that is impacting other things that are going on. So I think that's the first thing that, you know, I will be watching. I also think we have to watch how we are coming together as an international community to address this. You know, we've certainly seen instances in the past. If you look at Ebola here, where the United States led a international effort to address that in Africa and West Africa, these types of things are going to be important. And as the spread of this virus comes under better control in the westernized countries, we are going to have to be concerned about the areas where it is more difficult to control this. And so I think one of the things we should be watching is how do we come together internationally? You know, our greatest successes are done when we work with partners and work through coalitions. And so we should be looking at what are the coalition efforts, what are the international combined efforts at treating, preventing, recovering from this virus? And so these are the things that I would suggest we look at: leaders, what decisions are making, and then how we're coming together internationally.
We'll have to leave things there for now, but thank you very much for joining the podcast today, General Votel.
Thanks, Alistair. Great to be with you again.
And thank you as well to our audience for listening in and to our production team for their work on today's program. We will see all of you next week.
This has been a presentation of the Middle East Institute. To support MEI's programs and podcasts, please donate at www.mei.edu. Thank you for your support.